original song. It's something I don't play my originals so much anymore, so it's a bit of a stretch for me. It's something I wrote years ago. It was actually, I had a song fragment that was about this Jennifer's Habit. And I lost a friend of mine. Her name was Kim Folks in Hagerstown. And she was just such a beautiful person. If I may just say, she's a big black girl, and she's just beautiful and had a beautiful, amazing voice. And she was one of my best friends. And unfortunately, she died from AIDS. And this was many years ago. But when I lost her, I had this fragment. And I finished the song with her in mind, even though I didn't actually write it for her. It was a tribute to her, from my friend Kim.
Feeling. Welcome to our Valentine's Day special. Great job, Ted. Thank you very much. We look forward to having a great show tonight. To get off things going, let's first thank our hosts, Rick and Val Colby, who give up the room for us. Vic and Val. I am your MC, Steve HAZZARD, and we are here at Thursday night at the Creamery on Commerce. So let's enjoy this evening. We do have other shows coming, and we've done shows in the past. This is our seventh installment of this. We have some full-timers up here in the front row. We're a little concerned. Normally, they're sitting in the back, and there's a lot of chit-chat and errant conversation. So I told them that they'll have to pay attention. They're in front row. So we have Queen Anne's County Television here recording the entire event, which is wonderful. If you do want to watch previous events, they are available on YouTube under Thursday night at the Creamery. We've done this for an entire year now. Coming the 24th will be one full year. I know it's seven shows. We take the summer off. We got sailing, beach life, drinking beer on the beach, that kind of thing. So we take the summer off. But I'm quite surprised that we've made it this long. And we've made it this long all because of you guys showing up and we're having a good time doing it. You know, this past week we had Valentine's Day. And I talked to a married couple. They're in their 60s. And during their Valentine's Day, they had a special guest. A fairy shows up. Fairy says, I'll grant you both a wish. Wife sits there a minute, says, I'd like to travel the world with my darling husband. Well, the fairy waves her wand, boom! Two tickets to a luxurious cruise ship. Well, the husband says, well, honey, I'm sorry, but I'd like to travel the world with a wife who's about 30 years younger than me. And the fairy waves her arm and whoop! All of a sudden, he turned 90 years old. I tell you, it's all a matter of perspective, isn't it? Well, happy Valentine's Day. Again, thank you all for coming. We have a wonderful show tonight. We have our musical guest, Piano Ted, which he's formerly known as. Actually, his name is Ted Raschka, but everybody goes by Piano Ted around town. We also have storytelling Watermen, which should be an interesting thing. And they have the upcoming Watermen Swap this Friday. So get some information from them. Learn something of what they may be talking about. It sounds like a pretty good show, and it's there on It's in Graysonville. For some reason, when I moved here, Ken Island is everything. I don't know what it is. I don't know. I'm sorry. All right. We also have local author Jack Shaum. And he's going to speak to us. And we also, at the end of the evening, we have a special appearance from the Black Knights. But I tell you what, I enjoyed that song. Before I hear another, I'm thinking about another joke. Anybody want another joke?
Sure.
Why not? There was this. All right. I'm getting the hook. Anyway, so there's this guy sitting at a bar. This beautiful girl comes in. He can't believe she's coming to him and sits down next to him and talking to him. Well, after a couple minutes, he starts to get the taste, wait a minute, this woman might be a prostitute. So he sits there and he listens, and she says to him, you know, I want to play a game. What kind of game, he says? She says, I'll do anything you ask for $300, but you got to say it in three words. Well, he sits there and thinks for a minute, digs for his wallet, pulls it out, lays three crisp $100 bills right on the bar. She says, go ahead. He says, paint my house. Ted, another song. Yep. You're up, baby.
I'm going to play some originals tonight, but right here is a song of more of a Valentine's Day.
Okay, so
song,
you guys will be ready to go.
Some Sam Cooke.
Well, that sounds like the last one. Let's see. Goes.
I got it.
Don't know much about history, don't know much about biology, don't know much about a science book. Much about the French I took, but I do know that I love you, and if only you would love me too, what a wonderful world this would be. Don't know much about geography. Don't know much of trigonometry. Don't know much about a science book. Don't know much about the French I took. But I do know that I love you. And if only you would love me too, what a wonderful world this would be. Now I don't claim to be an A student, but I'm trying to be. Maybe by being an A student, baby, I could win your love for me. Don't know much about the Middle Ages. Looked at the pictures and I turned the pages. Don't know much about no rise or fall. Don't know nothing about nothing at all. But I do know that one and one is two. And if only I could be with you, what a wonderful world this would be. What a wonderful world this would be. What a wonderful world this would be. What a wonderful world this would be.
Thank you. Thank you.
Steve.
Well, it's time to welcome our first guests. Our first guests are the Troy Wilkins. Troy Wilkins bought his first boat when he was 14. He would walk to catch a ride to the landing to go crabbing. Troy's little work boat had a four-speed, four-cylinder Toyota engine and no reverse. Troy's maternal grandfather was a waterman. And Troy is the current president of Queen Anne's County Watermen's Association and is active in representing the interests of watermen in Annapolis and across the state. We also have with us Joe Horney. Has worked in the water since he first went crabbing with his father at age 10 or 11, he's not sure. His family has worked the waters around Kent Island for generations. Joey has used his other land-based skills at times during his decades-long career as a waterman, but the passion for working on the water remains first in heart and soul. Joey is a natural-born storyteller. Gives me great pleasure to introduce Troy Wilkins and Joe Horney. Come on up there, big fella. How you doing? Have a seat, guys. Share the mic. It's wonderful. You guys are here representing the Waterman's Story Swap, which goes on this Friday down at the Graysonville VFW. For those who are curious, which one is that? It's behind the tank. You know the tank? It's behind the tank. Okay. Right? So there's going to be a lot going on. What exactly is going on there? You guys just sit around in a circle, tell stories, or
no,
what?
We have around 10 people that have been telling stories. Uh-huh. We have some displays of some like Indian artifacts and things that Gosh dug up clamming. And Karen Ortel from Harris the Seafood is going to have I think she's going to talk and have a display set up. They're celebrating 70 years. This year, so getting a little bit of everything involved in, and autographs are going to be available afterwards or during to answer questions and just have a little talk with people about what's going on with us and what we do.
So your waterman, you can spin a heck of a yarn, right? You can tell a heck of a story, right?
Joey can.
Give me an example for us for the story you can tell. Do you have one you can share with us?
Well, like Troy, my first boat, my brother and I, we crabbed with my father, and we saved up enough money to buy this boat. So my father says it's like a 20-foot boat with a hurricane. When you start it up, it takes off. No transmission or anything. So we had to stay up in Gooden's Creek. Couldn't go out the creek. My father crabbed outside of it. So we crabbed a couple of days like that. We only had the boat like 2 weeks, I think, before we made a sail. But then, make a long story short, we would take turns steering the boat, and one would dip, and one would dip the crabs, and the other one would steer the boat. So I'd made a good haul, crabbed their lines, and caught a few crabs, and my brother, he wanted to dip. I didn't want to dip. I wanted to dip. I didn't want to steer the boat. So we were down in the floor fist fighting over who was going to steer the boat and who was going to crab. Well, my father, he's crabbing outside the creek from us, and He don't see us in the boat, and the boat's steady going along. he comes running in wide open in his boat, and he sees us down in the floor fighting over who's going to steer and who's going to dip. So needless to say, we had to take our lines up, go and unbait our lines, and wait in the truck for him. Until he got in, he crabbed later that day, and I think he ever crabbed in his life, just making us sit there. So I can hear him tell my mother when he got home that day, that's the cuss words. The boat's for sale. I'll take one with me one day and one the next day, but they're not going crabbing again. And that was our first boat.
Well, obviously that changed over time. So are you just crabbers?
Crabbers, oysterman.
Okay,
because full time, we all year long.
Pretty much anything on the water.
And what's it like out there on like a day like today? You go out?
Sometimes, if you have a product you work to catch on, work.
But it's awfully cold.
It gets cold.
How do you keep warm out there?
Plenty of clothes.
And work hard. Go hard.
To go hard and try to keep yourself warm.
All right. I see them go through the narrows constantly, even during the wintertime, and I'm impressed with the fact that they're going out there to bang against those waves and try to make a living, and that's wonderful. I think it's a very resourceful way to do it, but boy, I tell you, it doesn't look easy to me. I guess I'd just like to go down to Harris's and just...
Yeah, that's probably easy. That's what I usually do. If we have some, I'll get some already shucked because it's too hard shucking.
So the stories are good. But let's talk a little bit about the fishing industry here. You're involved in that, obviously. What's the biggest problem facing fishermen in the bay today? That's a broad and open-ended question, but I don't know.
Politicians? People in other counties, maybe like delegates, senators in other counties, mm-hmm. representing the environmentalists with their interests, you know, mm-hmm. with, I guess they have the money, the power, right. and you know, we're definitely a dying breed, you know, we're on the way out, you know, obviously.
Do you see any young people crabbing and oystering these days? When I say young, being like 21, 20, or maybe when you were.
Yeah, there's some young kids that do it, but.
We're the youngest now, ain't we?
Really? Yes.
But there are a few young, but they're just... It's
not that many anymore.
Well, what's the future hold for our crabbing and oystering industry here in the Bay? If we don't have anybody doing it.
If things don't change, you're probably getting it from the South.
I got you.
Yep.
All right.
Really.
All right. So your biggest hurdle is, of course, the legal issues, the environmentals holding you back and things of that nature.
Yes. Yes.
Are they over-litigated on these issues, you think? Or
absolutely.
When you look at their side? Because you got to look at both sides and find a median.
Yeah, that's the thing. You know, finding the median between the two, you know.
Right.
And a lot of watermen don't want to work with them, and a lot of the environmentalists don't want to work with the watermen. So it's hard to find that balance,
right.
Really.
Right.
Yeah, really.
That does make it easy. So what? 10 years from today, what are we going to see when we look out there? Other than you guys being out there, who else we got out there?
10 years, I probably won't be.
I'm going to be with you.
Are there some famous fishermen that you guys, when you were growing up, that you... were your idols, so to speak, people that you see out there all the time, wanted to learn where he goes, or
Ralph Lick.
Is it?
I mean, maybe, yeah, some guys were, you know,
yeah.
Some guys were definitely, I guess it's like in any job, some people are better than other people,
right?
You know?
Well, I know when I go out fishing, I don't catch a whole lot, Jackie,
yeah.
Easy. But then other people go fish the same grounds I just fished, they'll come back with a whole kettle. I don't understand it. So, yeah, it does.
Some people got that horseshoe, you know?
Yeah, that's it. They're always lucky, right?
Yeah,
it's definitely a knack in anything you do.
Right.
Yeah. So, the swap, you guys excited about that?
The storytelling?
Yes.
This is probably like the third or fourth time we've done it.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Yeah, we've done it at Chesapeake College in the spring.
Uh-huh.
And we've done it at
conference place down in Graceville.
Yeah, down in Graceville. So,
okay.
Thanks to Brent over there, we're gonna try to do it at the VFW, see how things goes, and maybe we can keep on doing it.
All right. Do you have any stories you can share with us?
I guess I can share a little. Mine, yeah. I don't think mine's as good as Joey's, but I...
Well, we'll be the judge of
okay.
that one.
A few years back, Orson, I had an elderly gentleman working with me, and he didn't want to go when it was a day like today, really, when he cold. So I found some other young guys that I would hop on with and I would go to work with. So it's a cold, windy day, and we go on out, and to make it ice, you gotta put a little salt down, and I guess I just didn't put quite enough salt down, and I took a little slip and went on overboard.
Oh, boy.
And they get me back in the boat and all, and I'm frozen to death, put the heat on. So I'm ready to go home. And they're hauling to a couple other boats around here. I think they're getting clothes so I can put some dry clothes on to get home. Well, they're going over here to get a pair of pants and to get some, a shirt over here and a coat.
Redressing you, huh?
Yeah, redressing. Well, they get another wardrobe for me. And then they go back to work. And I'm sitting there putting these clothes on. I'm like, ain't we going home? I'm cold. Like, get up. Let's go back to work.
How many hours did you end up staying out there?
We stayed there till 3 o'clock. We worked the whole day.
Oh, did you?
So, yeah.
So all it did was break stride. That's all it was. Did you have a good haul that day?
Yes, we did. We had a good day.
Well, that's fantastic.
Except for me.
You're just cold. My money counted the same.
Yeah.
Well, gentlemen, I appreciate you coming here to see us. I hope everybody will enjoy and go to see the Waterman Story Swap at the Graysonville Legion. It is this Saturday.
Yeah, does it?
24th. It's a follow. I messed up. It's on the 24th. It starts at 6 o'clock and goes till the stories are done. And from these two guys, I can tell you that's probably quite a bit of time. Gentlemen, thank you very much for coming. I appreciate it.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Well, Ted, you going to remember the song you're about to play? Let's hear another song from you, Ted.
You know, it's interesting because I never really play my original songs when I'm out and about. But this evening I'll play some originals for you. Here's one I'm going to try to remember because a lot of these songs I wrote many years ago.
You.
Thank you.
Nice job, Ted. Thank you very much.
Appreciate that. For
those of you who are enjoying Ted's original music, he has CDs available. Coincidence. They're available right here up front. Please help sponsor Ted. He would really thank you. All right, so welcome back, everyone. We're here live at the Creamery on Commerce on Thursday night. It's a great event. We've had one storyteller swap so far with Joey Horney and Troy Wilkins. We also have coming up here shortly would be Jack Shaum. But before we get to him, I'd like to remind everybody that we are here on Thursday nights. Our next show is on the 26th of March, and we'll be celebrating, of course, St. Patrick's
16th.
Day. The 16th. I'm corrected by everyone. Oh, perhaps the 16th, and if it goes well, we'll do the 26th. How's that, right? Anyway, so we have that coming up and something to look forward to. Queen Anne County Television is, of course, recording the event tonight, and we appreciate that. So you're all a part of a live studio audience. So be enthusiastic, all right? Make it sound like this thing is, yeah. There we go. We don't have the laugh track up top, so we got to use ourselves. We thank you for that. My next guest, of course, is Jack Shaum. I keep saying his name wrong. I apologize, Jack. Jack is a retired print and broadcast journalist who spent nearly 50 years in the business. He is an author of Lost Chester River Steamboats from Chestertown to Baltimore. A native Baltimore, he began a career as a reporter with the News American in Baltimore, then became a press aide to Maryland Congressman William O. Mills. That was followed by a nearly 30-year career as a news anchor and reporter for News Talk radio station WBAL in Baltimore. He left that position in 2002 and wrote for the Bay Times and Recorder Observer newspapers in Queen Anne's County for 14 years until retiring just last year, 2016. He rode his first steamboat at the age of 8, which started a lifelong love of steam-powered vessels. From 2002 to 2011, he also editor-in-chief the Quarterly Journal of Steamship Historical Society. He's also a Mid-Atlantic columnist from 1975 to 2011. He is a co-author of Majesty at Sea, A History of the Great Four Funneled Passenger Liners, and co-ghost wrote Night Boat on the Potomac. Obviously, we're about to deal with an underachiever. For 20 years, he and his wife, Martha, have traveled as lecturers on several East Coast cruise ships. They have two daughters, four grandchildren, and live near Chestertown, Maryland. Jack Shaum.
Thank you, Steve.
Well, how are you this evening?
I'm well, and yourself?
I'm doing fantastic.
Good. What a great crowd.
I tell you what, but don't screw up. They'll eat you. All right. They're tough.
All right. Well, I'm going to talk a little bit about having a career in journalism and also a little bit about being an author. You got the sense from the titles that Steve mentioned that I'm kind of interested in ships, and we'll get rolling on that right off the bat. When I was in high school, I was really interested in American history, and I thought, well, I want to be an American history teacher. So I went off to college and started to study American history, and then somewhere along the way, fell off the wagon, wound up in the Marine Corps for a couple of years. And when I came back, resumed college, and I was going to the University of Baltimore, and one of my professors there was a retired Baltimore Sun editor. And after about 3 or 4 months of classes, I went in one evening, he said, come here, I want to talk to you. And he told me on the QT that the old News American newspaper in Baltimore was looking for young reporters to help cover what they were expanding into the suburban area, not just the city at that point. I think you ought to apply, he said. So I applied and somehow got a job while I was still in college at a major metropolitan newspaper. Now, usually it works the other way around. Mm-hmm. Fledgling reporters will start at a small paper, weekly, daily, whatever the case may be, and work their way on up. I started at the News American, was there for 5 years, then had the other careers in between, and came to the Bay Times and Record Observer in 2002, and wrapped it up at the end of last August. But along the way, I've developed this incredible interest in ships. And let me tell you, let me read a little bit from the introduction to the book here to tell you how I got so interested in this subject. When I was 8 years old, my parents took me on an overnight trip down Chesapeake Bay from Baltimore to Norfolk on the venerable steamboat City of Richmond of the old Bay Line. It was only a 12-hour voyage, but for me, it might as well have been a transatlantic crossing on the Queen Mary. I was mesmerized about everything as I walked through that corridors of that 1913 vintage steamer. The polished interior woodwork, the brass facing on the main staircase, the stained glass domes over the main saloon. Yeah, that's what it was called, a saloon. The gentle pulsing of the engines far below, the rich tones of the steam whistle as it echoed across the water. Before that night was over, I became totally hooked because my mother knew Captain Samuel B. Chapman, the steamer's master, and that allowed us the opportunity to visit places usually off limits to passengers, the engine room, the pilot house, and to sit down for a visit in the captain's cabin, the walls of which were covered with all kinds of memorabilia of various Chesapeake Bay steamboats. Then the real magic occurred after dark, when Captain Chapman took me into the darkened wheelhouse, remember, 8 years old, took me into the pilot house with its gleaming brass equipment and a great wooden wheel that was even taller than I was. Before reluctantly going to bed, I had the opportunity to take the wheel, read the radar, and the next morning on arrival at Norfolk, the captain let me blow the whistle as we were coming into the dock. Now, how could an eight-year-old not be captivated by such an experience? Well, I was hooked. Very next year, Walter Lord wrote his classic book on the sinking of the Titanic, A Night to Remember. That just cemented this thing a little bit more. So I was into steamboats, I was into ocean liners. In fact, later on, when my, little commercial here, when I published my book on transatlantic liners, Majesty at Sea, back in 1980, Walter did the foreword for our book, and we were really, really thrilled to have an author of that magnitude to do this. And while I was with the Steamship Historical Society, we put out the book Night Boat on the Potomac, and it says edited by myself and my friend Ed Dunball, but in reality, we wrote the book. We wrote the book from the notes of the late Harry Jones, who died, unfortunately, before he could get around to writing it. So these two were co-authorships. And then finally, in 2015, here comes my own book with my name on it and nobody else's. And some may say, well, why did you write a book about Chester River? There's rivers all over the bay. There were steamboats all over the bay. How many of you remember the Bay Belle coming to Tall Chester and Betterton? Then there were the little steamboats that left Baltimore, and he went all the way down the lower eastern shore of Virginia. They went up places like the Occohanic River. Who's ever heard of that? The Piankatank River in Virginia. And these boats were not just excursion boats. They were not just taking partygoers up to a beach to have a good day. They carried passengers and freight, because back in the days before there was a Bay Bridge and before there were the ferries across from Mattapique to Annapolis, the steamboat was the only way to get around on the bay. And it wasn't just a matter of transportation, because folks here in the rural areas used the steamers, primarily the watermen and the farmers, to take their goods to Baltimore to market. Folks from living over here would take the boat to Baltimore for things like medical appointments, to visit with family, maybe go to the theater and whatnot. And then conversely, on the way back, the ships would bring to the eastern shore goods that weren't readily available over here, such as construction equipment, medicine, clothing, and that sort of thing. And it began in 1813, and the very first steamboat to come to the eastern shore came to Rock Hall in 1813, the only the second trip of a steamboat on the bay, and they kept going until 1923. Well, I knew that there had been steamboats on the Chester River, and living only about a mile and a half away from the river, I kind of got attached to the idea of writing about the river. And so, thank goodness for the old newspapers like the Record Observer, the Kent News, and Bay Times, a lot of their old newspapers were still in the back rooms of the office. So we were able to go in and see these firsthand accounts of what these ships were like. And so, History Press in Charleston, South Carolina, puts out Lost Chester River Steamboats. Now, one of my friends who was a captain of a coastal cruise ship said, Jack, how did they get lost? Well, that's a title that's part of the publishers. They have a specific theme on different things that aren't here anymore. So it was Lost Chester River Steamboats, Lost Streetcars of Detroit, and that sort of thing. And we uncovered an awful lot about life here on the Chester River, because imagine what it would have been like to try to get across to the other side of the bay before there was a bridge or before there was the ferry boats. And I found that there was a lot lurking in the archives around here that people didn't know about. And so I've tried to encapsulate as much of that about the Chester River and get it in this book, because it was one of the very first steamboat routes on the Chesapeake Bay. And somebody said, well, now you've done the Chester, how about the Choptank, how about the Miles, how about the Potomac and the Patuxent? There's not enough years left in my life to do all of that. But if anybody's interested in a really good general view of all of the steamships on the Chesapeake Bay, wonderful book done by two eminent Bay historians called Steamboats Out of Baltimore. It's published by the Old Tidewater Publishers down here in Cambridge. Can still be found in some of the stores. I'm happy to say that a lot of the local outlets around here in Centreville, Chestertown, down on Kent Island in particular, have been carrying the book. As far as I know, it's done really well, and I'm telling everybody to hurry up and buy it and not wait for the movie. So that's how I got going into steamboats. And one little word about the journalism business. That has opened a tremendous number of doors down through the years. I mean, I never thought when I was a kid growing up that I'd get to hobnob with senators and congressmen and cover presidents and even covered the Pope when he came to Baltimore. And just these kinds of things that I never thought I'd get exposed to. But my greatest experience in journalism didn't occur in Baltimore. It happened over here. Because six years ago, I got to accompany a Queen Anne's County educational delegation to China for 10 days. And I just came away absolutely enthralled and would love to be able to go back there. That is the high point after almost 50 years of being in the journalism business. And it's a very rewarding experience. Met a lot of terrific people. And reflecting on it, and somebody said to me, why don't you write your memoirs? And I thought for a minute, well, now how would I do that? I didn't keep a journal over the years. So I said, well, let's just concentrate, maybe do the radio business, because that's kind of a wacky business anyway. And I knew the title of the book. The book was going to be entitled, What Do You Do the Other 55 Minutes of the Hour? Because going on the air to do a radio news broadcast is the easy part. You got to do interviews. You got to cut up the tape. You got to decide the order that your stories are going to go in. Radio guys don't have producers and directors, so you're on your own. And that made it even more compelling and thrilling, and just to have had your finger on the pulse of the world. So that's kind of it.
Well, I'm done. Have a seat. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. You know, normally I'll have somebody come up here, tell a few bits about it, and it leaves a lot of air for openness. You didn't come. You born a day or night? I mean, you covered just about everything. So thank you very much for coming. It's some interesting information. I'm more intrigued right now, though, after listening to you, is about the radio business. All right. Obviously, you have the voice for it. It's kind of carries and a little, you know, thundering.
I know how to talk to a big room.
That's it. So anyway, and you mentioned going to China when you were a journalist, but you were in that radio business for 30 years. You were an anchor. There's got to be some incredible stories that you covered, which is now our history, which was then happening live. What were some of those more
shocking
stories?
Well, that's one of the things I like to say. There's a parallel, but there's a connection between history and journalism, because today's news is tomorrow's history.
Right, right, exactly.
Unfortunately, most of the stories that I could tell you, I couldn't tell in mixed company. There was just some interesting characters down
right.
through the year. I mean, some of you may remember hearing folks like Alan Prell on WBAL or Ron Smith, and those two guys were like oil and water, and they got together every once a week and fought it out. And we had news people that, you know, did some pretty goofy things that you didn't think a news person was going to do, but we all did it. It wasn't
right.
just one person. But it's funny, today I still have dreams at night sometimes about being in the radio business. And the dream usually goes something like this. The clock up on the wall says 12 o'clock straight up. I'm all the way across the room and I don't have a script.
You got to ad lib.
Hey, radio people use scripts.
Oh, sorry.
So right. that keeps coming back, as does the Marine yeah. Corps dream every yeah. now and then, too. Being in the Marine Corps at the age of 65.
So interesting. You, as far as your radio concerns, did you do all your writing? Did you
mm-hmm.
do all that?
Okay. You do. Back in those days, you did all of your own writing. You did your own interviews. And back in those days, it was reel-to-reel tape. And the sound bites that we played were on basically the equivalent of those old 8-track mm-hmm. tapes that we
right.
used to play in your car.
Yeah.
And when I first started, if you wanted to take a sound bite out of a big interview, you actually physically cut the tape with a razor blade and then you pasted the whole thing together and hoped that it held.
Yeah.
But it was amazing how fast time would go from the time you finished one broadcast until it was time to start another one.
Most prolific American you ever had a personal opportunity to interview?
Wow, it's tough. Well, I was in the presence twice of President Jimmy Carter.
Okay.
I was in the presence of Pope John Paul II when he came to Baltimore.
Oh, you mentioned that, yeah.
I guess some of the most interesting characters were folks from the Maryland legislature, some of the different senators and delegates. And no, but the legislature, if you take the time to look into it, is a fascinating business. Uh-huh. And I would have never known anything about the legislative process. I wouldn't have known anything about planning and zoning if I hadn't gotten into the news business.
Yeah.
So it really has, it has been an education. Somebody once said 4 years in the news business is equivalent to a 4-year college education, and I think there's something to that.
Where did you go to college?
I started off at Towson University in Baltimore, right. Then went to the University of Baltimore,
right.
Night school at that point.
Right.
And that's
you're already working on the radio.
And that's where I got my foot in the door with the old News America.
Now today, how would someone in their younger years, graduating from college per se, wants to get into journalism? How in the world would they do it?
Well, I think what you try to do, you have to determine what part of journalism you want to be. You want to be in broadcast? Do you want to be in print? If you want to be in broadcast, you're probably going to start as an intern at a local station. You might be the person that goes to get the coffee when you first start. Mm-hmm. But then later you pick up the business and eventually you're starting to be allowed to do certain things, and then it just builds from there. As for print journalism, I think that probably the way you get into it is kind of the way that I did. You're in college. I didn't finish it before I started in the paper, but you finish college, and then you just put your resumes out there, and you want to see what you can get with a small newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of the reporters that I've worked with here at the Bay Times and the Record Observer down through the years have been novices, some of them fresh out of school, and they've gotten their feet on the ground and gotten to know the business here and gone on to greater things. And I think that says volumes for the value of these local newspapers.
Absolutely.
And I also think that a lot of people have said, do you think newspapers are going to go down
good
someday
question.
Because of...
I wish I had asked that. Go ahead.
You want to try?
Hey, so a lot of people say the newspapers may disappear in the near future. What's your feeling on that?
I think that if any newspaper is endangered, it's probably the daily papers in the big cities, because they're up against the TVs, the radios, the CNNs, the 24-hour news station. But over here, the local papers that we've got, you're not going to get that news anyplace else. What's going on in my backyard? You're going to get it in the Bay Times and the Record Observer. You figure we've got a radio station in Chestertown, we've got a radio station in Easton, and there's nothing else. You know, so these papers, I think they're going to be around for a long time.
Okay. All right. So I appreciate you coming. Tell us about the Steamboats, but what other interests do you have? It's not Steamboats 24/7.
No, not 24/7.
What other interests do you have?
Well, I was a choir singer for a long time. I sang in church choirs for 50 consecutive years.
All right.
I've been interested in the American Revolution.
Oh, are you?
Yeah, and that's great.
Reenactor?
I tried it once, but I found out it was too expensive.
Yeah, yeah. Those guns
$700 for a musket.
Yeah.
Right. So the American Revolution, colonial history here in Maryland. The wife and I like to drive around and see what we can find on the back roads here on the Eastern Shore. And now that I'm retired, I'm doing some genealogy, and which is really cool because my grandmother came from the Eastern Shore, and we already got them back to 1680. So I'm having a wonderful time doing genealogy.
I mean, you moved to the Eastern Shore when you were older, though.
Right. We've been here 14 years.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
Yeah, it was funny because my daughter went to Washington College, and we kept coming over and visiting, and my wife, when she graduated, my wife got all teary one day. She says, I don't think we're ever going to see this place again. And then lo and behold, we thought, all right, let's just pick up, change our careers. Let's move over there and start anew. So I went to work for the paper. She worked at Washington College, and the rest, they say, is history.
Well, I'll tell you what, you live a wonderful life. We'd like to have you on longer just to learn more about you, but we got to make room for some other folks. But I appreciate you coming. Mm-hmm. Your book is available at stores around. We also have books available out in the gift shop, which you'll have to pass through, just like Disney, to leave the building. So make sure you pick up one of Jack's books, and I'm sure Jack would sign it for you,
absolutely.
Too. Mm-hmm. But thank you very much for coming this evening. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
How about we hear another one from my friend Ted here?
I had no idea what I'd play. Just something came to mind. It is a cover song by James Taylor, one of my favorites.
Town, you can laugh at me. It's as plain as rain that you've never been down to the Southern Sea. See see me now is like a watching a fish swimming on dry land. And I only wish you could see me down in the islands. Mister, that's my home. What a fool I was to leave the only happiness I've ever known. When you see me coming, you wink your eye and call me Captain Jim. And when I don't do nothing but to walk on by, you say, baby, get a load of him. All I need is the sea and the sky, and I know where I stand. Instead of you hicks straight out of the sticks and calling me half a man, just never understand. It seems up here I'm just a whiskey bum, but down there I'm a king. And it sounds just like the angels up in heaven when they sing, welcome home.
Time for another verse, or do I have time for another verse?
Yes.
Know that your Yankee whiskey is taking away my mind, and I know that rum is the only drink suitable to mankind, and I know that this tree I'm under with its shape entirely wrong, I need to see a gentle palm tree, and I won't wait too long. Feel it coming on strong. The first cold wind of winter is flapping in my clothes, and it's showing me the way with the direction that it blows. Say welcome home. Such a sight to see. And not some sad old Salvation Army sister singing nearer my God to thee. Let me hear it, oh no, welcome home. You're such a sight to see. And not some sad old Salvation Army sister singing nearer my God to thee.
JT. Thank you.
Once again, well done, Ted. Thank you very much. We're going to have a chance to interview Ted just here in a minute, so look forward to that. Thank you all again for coming. We are here at the Creamery on Commerce in Centreville. And we're enjoying our love theme for Valentine's week. Unfortunately, we missed it by 2 days, but we made it, right? So I would like to, at this point, welcome Ted as our next guest. Ted is Piano Ted, is formerly known as, is Maryland-based songwriter, performer, and currently lives on Kent Island. Performs at local restaurants and private events. On Sunday mornings, you can find Ted playing keyboard at the Congregation of Living Waters Lutheran Church in Stevensville. Ted has lived in Nashville, recorded 2 original music albums in his 35-year career, and he has performed with several rock bands across the state. Got to find out more about that. How he now plays piano in a quieter venues, but continues to write. Ted enjoys living on a sailboat and hopes to continue his music career for many years to come. Ladies and gentlemen, it's proud for me to introduce to you Ted Raschka. Well, Ted, Rolling Stones, The Beatles, Elton John, which one? If you had to pick one.
Stones.
Stones, okay, very good. All right, what was your earliest musical influence? What made you decide I want to play music?
Well, when I grew up, I played a lot of literature on piano. I had a piano teacher. I'll try to make this brief because I love talking about her. Her name was Lucille Etchison, and she had a big church in D.C., and she was an amazing lady. She was a real aristocrat, but she was just such a sweetheart, just a real genuine lady. And as a young child, she just treated me like gold, and all of her students. She was an amazing lady. I grew up playing literature, you know, Beethoven and Mozart and so forth. But I will never forget, to answer your question, I don't know what year it was, but many of you would remember, I guess, the year that Jackson Browne's album came out, Running on Empty, and it was the same year that Bruce Springsteen's Born to Run came out. And never forget, Christmas morning, my sister got me those two albums on vinyl, and I wore those albums out. I mean, especially Running on Empty, listening to those songs live and hearing the crowds and all, being so young and influential. And Jackson's such a great writer. He was probably, has been my biggest influence. I've met him, great guy. Yeah, we hang out, yeah. Shook his hand anyway. But anyway, once I started playing in bands, and I just, you know, I still love classical music, but my career took off at 18. I started playing for a living.
Okay. And you grew up, did you grow up in D.C. then? Is that?
Hagerstown, Maryland.
Hagerstown. All right. Yeah. So as far as your music's concerned, what do you listen to when you're not playing? It's just something you might listen to.
Anymore, it's hard for me to know what to listen to. It depends on my mood, you know. And with Pandora, it's just awesome because you can listen to so many different things. And I think a lot of people are enjoying that. You know, you can just, yeah. Depending on your mood, I listen to so many different types of music. I get bored with any one type, and I kind of have to switch around.
When you write your music, do you do it at a specific location in the house, on the boat, at home? Where does it come to you?
You know, I used to be a real serious songwriter when I was younger, and I lived in Nashville for a while. And to me, it wasn't so much about that. It was more of a job. It's like, you know, I had to schedule time to write, and I would sit and I would write, force myself to write, and it was not really fun. It was a job. I worked at it like that,
right,
very seriously. So it was.
You write the lyrics first or the song first?
Music for sure.
Music first.
Yeah.
You have a melody and then you match the lyrics to it. I've talked to others that do it the other way. That's why I'm just.
I know, so have I, but that's just the way it always came to me. But
right.
Here, because the sound, the feeling of the music would give me a sense of what the lyrics were.
Okay. You play guitar. I see you've got one over here. I've seen you play guitar before. Do you ever write music for the guitar versus a piano, or is it just all the same?
I like writing on guitar more because guitar to me is more percussive. I love the piano, but it's just a very different instrument. With guitar, it seems like it's easier to write a song on guitar, for pop music at least.
When did you get started? How young were you when you first, your first instrument, I assume, was piano, was it not?
Yeah, absolutely. Right. I was 11 when I started playing. Okay.
And it was the woman in D.C. that turned you on to it?
She had a church in D.C. She was from Hagerstown.
Oh, okay. All right. So you took lessons up in Hagerstown then?
Yeah. Some of you might know the museum in Hagerstown, Maryland, at the park. It's pretty known in Hagerstown. The Etchisons were pretty big as far as being curators and being involved with the museum there in Hagerstown. And she was part of that family.
You still keep in touch with her? She's still around?
No, she was pretty elderly. She was probably 80 when I had lessons at 11.
Oh, yeah.
So, and I did.
Jack, did you interview her?
I did visit with her a couple times when she went into the Horney Keedy home out. And she was so sweet. She had arthritis, but we would go to the piano, we'd sit and play, and I just have really fond memories of her. Very grateful to her.
In Nashville, you were writing. Did you write for anybody in particular, or were you writing just for yourself and trying to get your own album off the ground?
Yeah, I worked for a temp agency, and Nashville's difficult. I've always likened it to like moving to D.C. to try to be president. You know? you really have to be known before you go there.
Right.
It was interesting, but it was a difficult time for me.
So what advice could you give on some young man or some young lady who wants to be a musician? How do you get started? Other than learning an instrument, that would be an obvious. But how would you get started?
Well, I think the love for the craft has to go first, absolutely, because, you know, it's such an unfair industry. Everybody knows that. There's so many great people. When I lived in Nashville, I heard songwriters on writers' nights that were just so much better than anything you'd hear on the radio. You know, I think it's probably a very political thing down there where, you know, somebody has a nephew or niece and they're, you know, they're able to get through the industry. And there's so many talented people that, so if you're in it for the money, you're probably in it for the wrong reason.
Okay. So for the love of the craft. So Jackson Browne was your favorite, or at least it was when you first started out. If you had Jackson Browne sitting here and you could ask him one question, what would that question be?
Oh, well, wow.
That's a lot.
For that. It's funny, he's been very political over the years. One thing I admire about him, you know, he and I are probably a little off balance as far as what we believe politically. However, I really have a lot of great respect for him. He's really dedicated a lot of his life to great causes. When I met him, it was because of he was raising money for breast cancer, and you pay extra in Baltimore and you get to meet the performer. And I got to meet him that way, along with David Crosby and Graham Nash. And I have a lot of respect for him. And I think it, especially nowadays, you know, there's nothing wrong with us disagreeing. We should all come together for good causes.
That's well said, well said. How often are you playing now? Are you playing there a couple nights a week?
It's a little slow at the moment. It's uh-huh. winter time. I'm looking forward to summer and the dock bars and yeah. all that. But I'm very grateful to be at the church every Sunday. If you're all welcome, please come to Lutheran, Living Waters Lutheran. We're there every Sunday, and I'd love to see you. So one of my colleagues here, and Beth is here, so we have a wonderful time singing every Sunday.
So other than church, where else are you playing? When's your next gig?
I got to clear that up. We're worshiping the Lord. You're not a colleague. when it comes to singing in church, it's not like a business yeah. venture. We're there to worship the Lord. What was that?
Where are you playing your next paid gig, other than church? I mean, is there a bar, a restaurant, anything around here that we could all go see you?
I wasn't prepared for that.
No, okay.
I did.
All right. Well, you make your living playing music. Do you do anything else?
I do handyman work. Yeah, I do that. Okay. Today, but that's pretty boring, so I don't really want to borrow.
All right. Well, it's trying to get to know you, Ted. And this is one way we get to see you do handyman.
I actually really enjoy that. I'm a tool junkie. I love working on things and fixing yeah. things, and so I do that.
What's your forte? Woodworking? Drywalling? Metallurgy?
I enjoy all that. I'm a gearhead. I love working on engines.
Oh, engines. Really okay. That. Well, that could come in handy around here. Yeah. When did you move to the Eastern Shore? How long ago?
About 5 years ago. I got this bright idea. I'd get out of the music industry, and I went to MMI in Florida, Marine Mechanics Institute. Learned to be a marine mechanic, and I was building boats for Zodiac. But I got laid off and found out that the marine industry is not so easy.
Hmm. Much like the music industry
well,
is.
Well,
right?
When you play music, it's great, because I often said, you know, people who are like a bank teller, you know, if you're imagine a bank teller sitting in there, and then she counts the money out, she counts it right, and then you applaud and give her a drink, you know. It's like, music is awesome, because it's like, you know, it's like, I don't really know if I deserve all this, but everyone's so nice. And then they give you money.
Take it while it comes, right? So you played with some rock bands around the state. Which ones, any ones that we might know? Big rock bands or
no?
Big
I played with Chokers Wild and Frederick was probably the most known. I could name a bunch of names. I doubt if
anybody would know. Okay, well, all right.
No, I'm good friends with all the guys in the Kicks. They're good friends of mine.
Oh, are you?
Okay. Well, they were from Waynesboro, Pennsylvania, and I'm from Hagerstown, so
okay,
we're all pretty tough.
This your only album? I thought I read there was a second album.
Yeah, and that was so long ago. It didn't even come out on CD. It's one of those old
45?
What do you call those things?
Cassettes?
Cassettes, yeah.
All right. I don't even know who has a player anymore. Anyway.
No, so, I don't.
No. So are you working on any more of your stuff? Because it's very good. I've enjoyed it very much tonight.
I appreciate that. I would love to do a new album, yeah. And nowadays, the cool thing is, you know, with just a MacBook or even just an iPhone, you could make an album. This cost me about $5,000, and we did it on ADATs, which is like now dinosaur technology.
Uh-huh.
So I'd like to do another one, yeah.
You have songs written, something?
I do. I have a lot of songs I've never recorded yet.
Uh-huh. All right. Well, Ted, thank you very much. It's a pleasure getting inside you here and figuring you all out. You played some beautiful music tonight, and I'd like you to play another one if you would. Can you get ready and do one more for us?
Yeah, sure. I'll play the title cut from this. This title is of this CD is 700 Miles, and I was living in Nashville in 1993, and I was a bit homesick. And it's probably, I don't write many songs about love. It's Valentine's Day, and they asked me to play some love song. This is like the one song that I wrote that it was actually a bit of a love song, so I'll play this for you.
All right, well, thank you very much. While you're getting organized here, I'm going to say my goodbyes. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're getting near the end here. We still have to see this evening of the Black Knights, but they're coming after Ted does his final song. I thank you all for coming. I thank Rick and Val Colby for allowing us to come here. Happy Valentine's Day to all of you, and we appreciate it. Queen Anne's County Television, thank you for recording. For those of you who haven't had the opportunity to see the other shows, just go on YouTube, put on Thursday Night at the Creamery. You can binge watch all weekend, okay? So get caught up on what you might have missed. Our March lineup, we have music. We had a cancellation today, so we're working on that. It's always a work in progress. These musicians are nice enough to come in and do this for us for free. I didn't tell you that till now, Ted. I apologize, but you don't get paid. I'm sorry.
What?
Well, play the last song. Maybe we can work it out, all right? So anyway, it's nice to have them come, though, and perform for us. We're going to have Tom Walsh. He's going to present us with different Irish poems. So that is also on the 16th of next month. Andrew Kelly from Island Blackwater Distilling. Going to show us how to make our own brew, all right? And whiskey, that is. And then, of course, we'll have the Black Knights again next month. Remember, our March lineup is very important. Your attendance here is very important. We can't do this without you. So please keep coming. And I'm going to send things off to Ted. Ted, are you ready to go? Thank you very, very much. Happy Valentine's Day. Good night.
There's smoke in the air on a cold southern evening south of the Kentucky line. In the light of my Ford, rolling down 24, I see the sign for Springfield now. And all my thoughts are of home with the ones that I've known and the warmth of the one that I love. And I will sing you a song 700 miles long on this cold Tennessee night, on this cold Tennessee night. Move along, move along, through a difficult life, through the laughter, the tears and the pain. And I will sing you a song 700 miles long on this cold Tennessee night, on this cold Tennessee night. With your funny, childish ways. I love all the light that you bring to the darkness of my days. There's smoke in the air on a cold southern evening south of the Kentucky line. In the light of my Ford, rolling down 24, I see the sign for Nashville now. And all my thoughts are of home with
with the ones that I've known and the warmth of the one that I love. And I will sing you a song 700 miles long on this cold Tennessee night. On this cold Tennessee night.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that.
Without further ado, the Black Knights.
Thank you, Steve.
You know, we've learned the last couple months the nice way to end the show is with a sing-along. I was talking to Joan and Don McDonald before the show. And I don't know about you guys, I'm 70 years old now. Every morning I wake up between the headlines and the yada yada. It's like a big headache. So this is February, which the theme is love, and calm it down a little bit. So let's do this.
How about everybody grab a hand to your left, grab a hand to your right. Go ahead. Okay, come on. You can grab your wife's hand. Come on. They won't bite you. Grab a hand. Come on. There you go. Grab a hand. There you go. A little physical contact. If there's any heavy breathing going on, you got to stop it, all right? Okay. All right, we thought we'd end up tonight. What the world needs now is love, more love. So join those hands. If you want to sing with us, sing with us. Forget all this Facebook yada yada, political yada yada. Here we go. Ready? One, two, three. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just too little of. But the world needs now is love, sweet love. No, just for some, but for everyone. Lord, we don't need another mountain. There are mountains and hillsides enough to climb. There are oceans and rivers enough to cross, enough to last till the end of time. Is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that is just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. No, not just for some, but for everyone. Lord, we don't need another meadow. There are cornfields and wheat fields enough to grow. There are sunbeams and blue beams enough to shine. Oh, this is the Lord, if you want to know.
Now squeeze your hands and sing.
What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just too little of. What the world needs now is love.